Good evening. Welcome to Diversity of Water Vision. I'm Joe Amprey, and I'm excited about tonight's program. They say that people in sales or in business for themselves are the happiest people. They're people who control their fate directly. The problem is that so many of us don't have the gumption, the chutzpah to get up and do it and say, I'm not going to depend on a boss. I'm going to do it myself. But if you've had a notion about starting your own business and making it work, I have three experts here who will give you the nuts and bolts of how to really start and run your own business. My guests tonight are David Navarro, who is a writer speaker. David, thanks for coming.
Thank you for having me.
Chuck Holder, a business consultant who has owned his own businesses and now he advises people who want to start and run businesses. Chuck, thanks for coming.
It's always a pleasure, Dr. Amprey.
And Luis Guzman, actually it's Luis Omar Guzman, who is the business development officer for Wells Fargo. Luis, thank you for coming.
Thank you for the invite.
Chuck, so how do we start a business? What do we do? What do we have to keep in mind if we want to start and run a business?
That's a really good question because there's so many different facets to what it takes to not just start a business, but to be successful at it. And success comes in many different forms. It's what are you looking to get out of it? Are you in the right business? Is it the right time to be in business? Are you prepared for it? Are you surrounding yourself with the right people? There's so many different factors involved with what you would term to be your success in business. And a lot of it is, what a lot of people don't understand is to be successful, 90% of the work that you have to do doesn't involve in what you're good at or what you think you want to go into business for, because in many cases, somebody's a good carpenter or a good plumber and they think, well, I want to be in business for myself. And that's all well and good, but the fact of the matter is, actually doing that work is just a small part of what it takes to be successful in business. You have to understand insurance, you have to understand the legalities of it, you have to set up the finances, you have to surround yourself with the right people. So it's a lot of work. And quite honestly, one of the things, and David and I had a conversation about this earlier today, is it's not easy. The best thing about having your own business is you can really, if you do it right and you have the success that you're looking for, it's the one opportunity that you're probably going to have to live life on your terms. And that's a great way to be able to live. But for all your family and friends that think that you just have the easiest thing going in the world and it's just great every day, that's not the reality of it. It's very difficult. And it's just the most important thing is to get started on the right foot. A good business plan, consulting with the right people. You know, one of the reasons we wanted Lewis to be here today, this evening, was because, you know, most of the time when somebody comes to me and they say, I want to start a business, and one of the first questions you ask is, how are you going to finance it? And they go, well, I'll go to a bank. Well, that's great. Which bank? Is it the right bank? Is that bank, are they going to get to know you? Are you going to build a relationship with that bank? That's very important. So maybe that's something that Lewis wants to touch on, because building that relationship with the right people, that's a great place to start. Would you agree?
I would agree. Basically, when you come up with that idea and you have that dream, let's say, for you to put into place a service or a product that nobody else offers or nobody else can offer it the way you can offer it, it is important to start on the right foot and start with the right relationships. Chuck had mentioned, you know, banking relationships. I like to see it a little even further than that. Banking is a small part of getting the ball rolling. You need people that are going to lift you up. You need people that believe in you, believe in your idea, and are going to encourage you along the way. A bank, I know in my field, I serve as an advocate. Advocacy is something very big and very important for businesses to get off the ground, and not just that, but also thrive as well. So you need to find somebody that is going to encourage you and really push you and give you the tools and the knowledge, the education to get you to the next step. So absolutely, Chuck. I mean, that is definitely something that you would want to be mindful of right off the bat.
By the way, we're live on Monday the 10th from 8 to 9 p.m. If you have a question, give us a call, 610-378-0426. Again, 610-378-0426. 378-0426. We'd like to answer any questions you have about starting or running your own business.
Another real key aspect of it is getting enough information for what you're trying to do. A lot of times we'll talk to somebody or somebody will come to see if we can start working together, and I'll say, you know, what kind of legal team do you have? And they go, oh, I have the best attorney in the world. And I go, well, that's good. But if they're the best attorney in the world, do you think that, you know, you're their only client? Are they thinking about your needs every day? They could be very conservative, and maybe being conservative in your business at this point isn't the best thing for you. The point I'm trying to make is always get enough information to make a qualified decision. Don't talk to one person, don't talk to one attorney, don't talk to one financial advisor, talk to several. Talk to several insurance professionals so that you're getting enough information that you can compare apples to apples and at the end of the day say, this is where I'm most comfortable. A lot of the information you get are just the perspectives of people that, you know, they know it because it's their business. They work with it every day. But you have to build those comfortable relationships and find the right people to work with, if that makes sense. It's very, very important. You have to have that comfort level. Most companies or people that start a business, we strongly urge them to have an unofficial board of directors, mm-hmm. just professionals that they can kind of talk to when things aren't going right. Have a mentor, get a mentor in your life, somebody that, you know, when something's not going right, you can call them up and say, hey, you know, I'm having a pretty rough day, or I have a question about this, I have a question about that. What do you think? Just so that you're constantly moving forward, talking to the right people. We talk all the time. I like to mention the fact that I grew up in the city of Reading in the 60s and 70s. And quite honestly, we grew up with a basketball, a football, and a baseball, and I love sports. That's what we did as kids growing up. And I still love sports, but small business has turned into my sport. Because if you're not growing every day, if you're not coaching yourself every day, if you're not getting better every day in your business, you're losing because somewhere you have a competitor that is doing those things. And if you have to constantly look for ways to get better. So maybe a great question is to ask David, who's starting his own business or has just started his own business, what are the challenges that he faces in business?
Great question. I think for me, the challenges were some of the things that you spoke about as far as getting those things right on the ground, on the foundations, mm-hmm. like setting up the foundation. I think that's one of the hurdles that I've run into, and I think that's a lot of what some of the hurdles that other people are running into or have run into is just setting up that foundation and making sure that you have all your ducks in a row as far as the legalities, the banking side of the finances and all those things.
Yeah, very good.
Maybe we should tell the audience that you just published a book.
I did in April of this year, yep.
And the book is about?
The title of it is Make Love Your Religion, How to Put Love First and Succeed at Doing What You Love. And it is about my journey to become a full-time writer and speaker, and also encouraging other people to do whatever it is that they love to do and to consider that a spiritual act, that when we're using our God-given talent, no matter who we believe God to be, that could be a form of religion for us. So it is part memoir, part self-help, and there's also a workbook element. So people can actually write in it and hopefully go back to it. And it's really geared towards people who are pursuing a dream, entrepreneurs, dreamers, and just encouraging them to go after whatever it is that they love to do and to do it and that they can, planting that seed that they can do it full time, to believe in themselves and that they can do it if it's something that they want to do.
We hear over and over again the expression, do some kind of work or job that you like. It will never work a day in your life.
Yes.
It sounds like you've kind of done that.
Yes, for sure. I always say that I only do the two things that I love, which is work with young people and write. So that's what I've been blessed enough to be able to do.
Good for you.
Thanks.
You might want to mention your publishing company, too.
Yes. So I, instead of just going strictly the self-publishing route, I created an independent press, SDJ Press, which I put my book out under, and I've created that in hopes of putting out more books and also helping local authors be able to publish books, and me being that person, that company, along with my two partners, to be able to do that.
So your business is your full-time job?
Yes, for sure. I work very part-time at Reading High School.
Oh, that's fantastic. And that's a part of working with the young people.
Yes, yeah, that's the other part that I love.
That is great.
Yes.
I know a lot of people who have been in music or in theater, And their problem has always been being able to do that full time. Somehow they're involved with something till the real big payoff comes from there. And it's so good to hear that you're doing that already. That's exciting mm-hmm. because so many people, and especially in music and in art, they are looking for that break. And there's some writers doing the same thing. They're mm-hmm. they're writing a novel, but they're working somewhere.
Right.
You know, but they're writing when they can. And then when the novel sells or goes well, mm-hmm. then they say, hey, I'm doing
it. Yeah, I think at some point you have to plan and also just be willing to take that big step to just kind of put everything on the line and say, okay, I'm going to leave this part-time job or leave this full-time job so I can really pursue what it is that I love to do. But also I think it's sometimes people take that step a little too soon and then they find that they have to kind of regress because they mm-hmm. didn't plan it out quite the way that they needed to. So I don't ever encourage people to like just jump off the deep end and pursue what it is that they think they should be doing. More so like create a plan so you can take the steps necessary to leave your 9-to-5 so you can work on that dream that you've been thinking about.
Chuck, the other thing that always fascinates me is that those of us who are afraid to go in business for ourselves, we might work 8 hours a day. We might work, or maybe there's overtime. But I'm told that many people start their own businesses, start out working 12, 16 hours a day, but of course it's a passion. Mm-hmm. And so it's not as overwhelming because it's their passion. And then eventually when things begin to fall into place, they may not work as long. Does that happen sometimes?
Absolutely. One of the things, and it's kind of roll over from what you were just mentioning, is one of the things that I kind of bristle about on occasion is the term starving artists. Hmm. When people say, oh, I'm in the arts and you know I just can't make it happen. If you sit down and do what it takes to start a business, more often than not, you can make a living do what you like to do, mm-hmm. and it all starts with a business plan. I can't sit here and absolutely tell you that the only way you're ever going to be successful is to write a business plan, but I can tell you from experience of all the business people I know, 90% of the most successful business people do have a business plan, It's amazing how people resist writing one. It really is fascinating, and we'll get Lewis to touch on this in a minute or two, how the banking industry looks at it, because most people think that a business plan is a document you write to go to the bank to get money, and nothing could be further from the truth. A business plan is to tell you everything you need to know about your business. What are your competitors doing? What is your target market? How are you going to market this? What regions are you going to be successful in? It's all about learning the things about your business that you need to know to be successful. And again, I will not tell you you have to have one. I do know some companies that have been successful without them, but a vast majority of the people who write a business plan, it's a living, breathing document that guides your business as you move forward. And it's very important when you do go to the bank. Do you want to touch on what you're looking for?
Absolutely. I mean, the way I try to put it to people is when you do go to a bank or when you go to somebody and you request a little bit of assistance, right? Put yourself in that bank's shoes. Let's say if you were the sole decision maker as to whether or not you'd be able to lend that money. You want to make sure that you're going to get paid. You want to make sure that whatever you are borrowing, that you can pay it back. So one of the ways that you can really show a bank that you have your ducks in a row is this business plan. And like you said, it is not a static document. No. A business plan will continue to change as the industry changes, as your business changes, as you as a person change. But it is very important to utilize those resources in the beginning to make sure that the plan is a solid one and it is a convincing one. It's one that you can really adhere to and know when to make adjustments so that you are able to thrive and you're able to evolve as your business grows and progresses. And the importance of the business plan really comes into play when you are requesting financing or when you are requesting a helping hand from a financial institution to take it to the next step or even to take the first step. So it needs to be something that you put a lot of thought in. And just like any creation, the more you invest yourself in it, the more you'll feel close to it and the more it'll help you to get to wherever you need to go. So definitely business plans are something that you do really need to have. And like you said, there may be a couple one-off situations where, you know, you made it big without having one, but really it's an exercise that can help you get off on the right foot and really take you to where you want to go.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. One of the things we talk about, Dr. Amprey, is when we're interviewing clients for the first time is, and they think you're out of your mind, and you look at me and you say, what do you want out of your business? What is your exit strategy? And they, well, I haven't even started yet. I don't care. I want to know if you're going to risk all this time and all this money, what do you expect out of your business? What do you want to walk out of in 5 years, 10 years, 20 or 30 years? What do you want to walk out of, and what would make this the perfect business for you? And it's, you can't build a path to something if you don't know where that path is going. And that's one of the things that we like to you know, make sure, because that's part of what you gear your business plan towards.
We have a caller. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hey, good evening. I've been in business in 1993. I remember when I went to business, I tried to approach the bank to try to get a loan. And I talked to a friend of mine. I said, hey, I'm going to go to the bank to see if I can get a loan. He said, yeah, it's very easy. When I went to the bank to borrow my first pickup truck, the only thing that I have as a collateral was my lawnmower. I said, really? Yeah. And I said, oh, that's very nice. So what happened is that here in Bear County, it's very hard for minorities to get loans. And even if you have a business plan, I mean, it's very tough with the bank. But the friend of mine happened to be a white guy. And he told me, yeah, if you go to the bank and you are white and you don't have a lawnmower, you can get a loan for a pickup truck. I said, really? That was in 1993. So I don't know how that is now, but it's now it's very hard to get a loan with the bank. Even with Wells Fargo. I have been with Wells Fargo for a long time. I have a good credit, and I tried to go there to get a loan, to get a line of credit. They put so many excuses. So, I don't know what's going on. So, try to fix everything, because that's the problem with minority business. To get along here in the rain is very hard.
You've been in business since 1993. That's 25 years. Have you gotten any loans at all? Are you still there?
I think he hung up.
I think I lost him. Well, I'm glad he asked that question, because I think, Luis, you probably almost answered it already. And I think the bank wants to believe that your plan is so good that they know they're going to get their money back.
Correct.
In other words, if I want to, I've always told that the way you can borrow money is they've got to be sure you're going to pay them back. That they believe in your plan, they see it has potential.
Right.
And if it doesn't have potential, then they're not going to want to lend you the money.
Correct. Right.
And so I think that and Chuck, and you're talking about a good plan. The good plan has everything in it about how you're going to get started, how you're going to market it, where your customers are, how you're going to make the money if that's necessary to pay the bank back.
Well, let's address the gentleman's question. He was having a difficult time getting a loan, and there could be many reasons for that. One of the things, as a consultant, what we would do is sit down and look at his current position, because a lot of times when people are looking to start a business, they're not able to start at that time, which is okay. But what can we do? What do we have to do to get you a position, to get you into a position that you can go to a bank and that they will give you a loan? It's not unusual for people not to be able to get loans. It's part of the world we live in. But that doesn't mean that you can't prepare for that. And maybe you can do it in 6 months. Maybe you can do it in a year. You would agree with that?
No, I would agree. And I think, you know, the gentleman mentioned a certain year, which, 1993, I think he said. Things have changed. Some loans have become a little easier to obtain. There are different programs out there depending upon what criteria you fit in. Other loans have become a little bit more difficult. There are regulations out there that make it a little bit more challenging to obtain the type of funding and financing that you need. But I think at the end of the day, the best thing to do is to educate yourself, figure out or ask why was the loan declined, upon what criteria, what needs to change in order to get that loan approved, you know, the next time, sure. 6 or 8 months down the line.
I hope you're still listening, because we're going to give you some numbers to call, because Chuck is a consultant for going into business. And of course, Luis is at a bank. And but I think the bottom line is that, and I think the fact that you've been in business since 1993, that in and of itself could impress someone.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And you're going to show them how, you know, what your income is, where your customers are. And it sounds to me that you've been in business since 1993, 25 years. That's impressive. And you probably have done some things that could impress a bank or a lender.
Yeah. May I also share one other bit of information with the caller and for other folks who might be out there listening to this? There are a lot of agencies you can go to get help and information. There are local SCORE chapters. There are SBDCs. There are incubators. We have a group called Entrepreneurs Connection that we help people get started in business. So feel free to call us when we give you our contact information, and we'll be happy to share those numbers with you, because there is help out there if you are serious about starting a business.
Another caller. Good evening. You're on the air. Thanks for calling. Hello? Did you hang up? If you did, please call back. We'd like to answer your questions. Maybe we missed you, but we're going to be here until almost 9 o'clock, so feel free to call back if we got disconnected somehow. But we want to try to answer any questions, because we're here to encourage people to go in business. I mean, I think it's exciting that I think, Chuck, you've had several businesses yourself,
yes.
And then you have advised lots of people about businesses, so you can answer a lot of questions about going into business.
Yes. It's... And, you know, David would have firsthand knowledge of that, because a lot of times you don't understand what it takes to start a business. I meet people who just know they want to be in business. They don't know what business to. So a lot of times it's even finding the right business for them. And also, again, you know, I'm sure David can expand on some of the trials and tribulations he had starting his business. The most important thing is to get the information from business professionals who can help you. You know, a story I like to share is, for years, I didn't like my insurance man. To me, it was a necessary evil. It just, you know, I used to go as far to say, did you ever notice how everybody you didn't like in high school became an insurance agent? And I was kind of kidding about it, but I had a point to make about it, too. And about 10 or 15 years ago, I was in a meeting and made this silly little comment, and a good friend of mine who's an insurance professional just kind of shook his head and looked at me. He said, Chuck, you don't get it. I said, what don't I get? He said, you're the kind of guy that knows you need insurance for your business. So what you'll do is you'll go out and get 4 or 5. Do you want to answer that? Go ahead. Go ahead.
You're on the air. Hi. Are you there? Good evening. Thanks for calling.
Yeah, this is me again. I'm sorry. Thanks for calling back.
Yeah. Did you have another question? Well, let me just say this, because you've been in business for 25 years. That's impressive. And I would think of...
Yes. And let me explain to you what happened here. I was the first minority to get a license in the city of Reading. So when I went into business in 1993, I got a contract with the Reading Housing Authority. I got the first contract for $40,000. And then they asked me for a bonding. I went down, I didn't know what a bonding was. So I went down to Philadelphia. And I say, I need a bonding. I say, I talked to a, I want to be honest with you, I'm going to be straight. I talked to a white guy and said, we don't give money to minority here. It happened that there was a guy there, a black guy from Philadelphia, who listened to me, and he said, oh, wait a minute, come here, let me talk. I want to give you the bonding. So he gave me the bonding for the $40,000, and I got the job from the Reading Housing Authority. When my next project came up, the Reading Housing Authority asked me for $200,000 bonding. So I went down to Philadelphia again, to the same place, and the young black fellow from Philadelphia already left the company. So I couldn't get into $200,000 bonding. So I know some guy in Reading who got started business with me the same time, and he became a millionaire. I never could get a bonding. So I couldn't ever do my business. the situation here is very, I don't know if things are changing now, but in 1990, it was very tough for a minority to realize in Israeli. And I was very tough to grow a business. So, I don't know how to explain, but I still in business. I still survive. But it's very tough for a minority business to grow a business in Israeli. That's my experience. That's what I could say.
Well, thanks for calling. We're going to give you some numbers now. Because you can, I think it sounds like the people who could probably help you most would be either Chuck or Lewis, depending on what kind of business you're in. Because Chuck has helped all kinds of businesses, and of course Lewis is in a bank. And sometimes, even if they can't help you themselves, they can point you in the right direction.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
So, Chuck, give him a number, please, if you would.
You could reach me, Chuck Holder, at 484-638-3975, or feel free to email me to chuck@chuckholder.com.
And did you get that? Do we need to repeat it for you? You got it?
Yeah, I got it.
Okay, we're going to give you Lewis's number also. He's with a bank, and he can tell you about other banks also, and he's an advocate for business. Give me your number, please.
Actually, the best way to reach me would probably be via email, so I'll start with that. That would be Lewis, spelled L-U-I-S, dot, last name Guzman, G-U-Z-M-A-N, at wellsfargo.com, or you could call the office 610-378-6700. Let's have a conversation, try to figure out, let's get to the bottom of, you know, what happened, how we can perhaps approach this a different way and take it from there. Definitely interested in hearing your story and learning more about what you do and why you do it so well.
Is this Jorge Blanco?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
I thought that was your voice. Way back when we started Mineco, you were around, and so I'm impressed that you are still in business. And by the way, how's your golf game these days?
Yes, I
are you still hitting that ball long and straight?
Yeah, I still survive. I move out of ready now, but I still in business.
Okay, well, we you have the numbers, and please give us a call. And thanks for calling the show. And I knew you 25 years ago, and I'm impressed that you're still at it. So that says a lot about you.
Yeah, okay. Thank you very much. Have a nice day.
All right, take care.
I did.
I mean, yeah. Good evening. Bye-bye.
David Hess.
Did you have another question? Oh, wow, you wanted to make a comment, Dave.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like I can still make it. I think he brings up a great point that we haven't addressed yet as far as minorities getting, sometimes if you're a minority, your path may be a little bit different than someone who belongs to the majority. I think he brings up a valid point that we can maybe address is how, are there specific resources for the minority business owner in Reading, being that the population is what it is here and the environment is what it is here. I think we should address that just a little bit. Are there resources that you guys know of specifically for the minority business owner? I know I went through the KU SBDC, Small Business Development Center, and I was in class with other minorities. Some of the classes I know are taught by minorities, and just that alone, being with someone who you can identify with racially or ethnically, can kind of ease some of the nervousness or the tension or the obstacles that may arise as you're trying to put your business together. So maybe the Kutztown Small Business Development Center could be a resource for him. I took my class at the Berks County Community Foundation, which was very diverse, and there were other minorities there that I'm sure may have been dealing with the same struggles that he dealt with. So I didn't know if you guys knew of any specific resources for minority business owners.
Jorge, if you still watch, we're going to give you Writer's Cramp, because we're going to give you another number. I hadn't thought of that until Luis mentioned that. I mean, until David mentioned that. You can call Kutztown University at 610-683-4000. Again, that's 610-683-4000. And ask for a Small Business Development Center. I know of some minorities who have gone through them and gotten businesses started. Mm-hmm. So again, that's Kutztown University, 610-683-4000, and ask for a Small Business Development Center, and they can give you lots of advice in terms of, so we're going to call all of us, call all these numbers, and I hope you're still in business 25 years from now. You've been in business 25 years. That's in itself is impressive.
Well, it is a diversity program, and that was part of the things that I prepared for, because it is very interesting. there are challenges with minority-based businesses, but there is lots of help out there to help you with those challenges. One of the things, if you are 25% of a minority, then you can get minority status for that. There are government programs that are available to help you with those things. There you might want to contact your state senator, your congressman to find out what programs are available. You can find out some of those programs through the SBDCs, the SCORE chapters. And also there's a help with minority-owned companies with government funding and things like that. And also, there is a, I mean, I work, I have worked with every type of minority in business. There are successful ones. It's just like anything else. It's, are you getting started in the right foot? Find out what's available to you. Find out what the challenges are as a minority owner, business owner. They are there. They're real. But if you address them in the beginning, you're going to be better off in moving forward. It's the same thing. The better you prepare in the beginning, the better off you're going to be prepared for success.
It's amazing. We had something called Mineco years ago, and he was part of that, which was a guy named Ted Hart started that. And of course, Tom McMahon was very much involved with that. And the whole idea was to help minorities get started in business, because there are some obstacles that we face, and we must meet them head on and overcome them.
Absolutely.
You know, I guess we may want to share with people the fact that we've said get a plan, and it sounds like almost a cliche, but they always say if those who fail to plan to fail, because we just have to really look ahead. What kind of obstacle can you expect? Who will contribute? Who's your population going to be is a very important question. Who am I going to serve? And I think a thing that's always fascinated me is that I've always wanted to do something that I like to do. But I'm amazed the number of businessmen who didn't pick their favorite field, but they asked the question, what need is there?
Yes.
What need does the public have, and how can I meet that need? Where are people spending their money? And I consider myself a psychologist, but I learn more about people from business people, because they know how you spend. They know how you spend your money, what your values are, and they meet those needs. And there are lots of businessmen who didn't go into the field that they particularly like themselves, but they asked that question, what is the need, and how can I meet that need?
Yes.
And it's a major question. And I think while you talked about what you like to do, Chuck, you like helping people.
Yes.
And so that doesn't have to fall into any particular kind of business. But taking a guy who says, I'm struggling, I can't get my business going, what can I do? And you can sit down with him and talk about what he needs, and maybe a business that you aren't interested in per se, but you can focus him so that he can focus on what he needs to know about that particular business.
Right. It's interesting, because people will ask a question, are you a business coach? Are you a business consultant? And the reality is, we're business strategists. Where are the problems? Where are the issues? Listen, starting a business is very difficult. We recognize that. And no matter how well you plan, I promise you there's potholes in front of you, there's speed bumps, there's landmines and earthquakes. They're there. They're real. If you think you can start a business and plan exactly how it's going to go for the next year and everything's going to go just the way you think it is, you're crazier than I am thinking I'm going to be a professional golfer someday. It's just not the reality of it. But if you've already have a plan to get somewhere, when these things come up, when these issues pop up, it's easier to handle them because you're already on a path to something. There are challenges every day in business. And again, surround yourself with the professionals. Let me go back to my insurance story. I never liked my insurance people, because to me it was an unnecessary evil. It cost me money and I never used it. And a guy said to me one day, he said, you know, Chuck, you just don't get it. He said, you're a businessman, you know you need insurance. So what you do is you go out and you'll get 5 quotes and you'll go with the cheapest quote. And when you don't have the insurance that you think you should have, it's our fault, not yours. Mm-hmm. And as soon as he said that, he educated me on the value of having the right insurance person. And that's in every form of your business. I know when I first started business, I was making HR decisions, I was making insurance decisions. I didn't have any experience or knowledge in any of those businesses. I was making decisions based on what sounded good. And that's where you run into problems. And so that's why it's important to talk to people like David and to Lewis and you know, surround yourself with the right people. Ask a lot of questions. We've given you SCORE, SBDCs. Talk to people. There are a lot of people out there that want to help people. And you're exactly right. If you're fortunate enough to find a need that serves a community, that's a great way to start a business. And another way is do something you like to do. A lot of people have turned incredible, have started incredible businesses from hobbies they've had. So there's a lot of way to do this.
Well, again, don't be bashful about calling them. The numbers will be given you because they can help you get started. Mm-hmm. And oftentimes we undersell ourselves because we haven't done this. But again, I'm impressed with people who surround themselves with people with things they don't know. I always say that you have certain skills and you start a business, but the people who you hire, who you bring on board, mm-hmm. can assist you in where you need help. A lot of local people are upset about the Eagles right now, but they're not doing well.
They should be.
And one of the comments you hear is that there were two great assistant coaches who helped Dave Peterson last year. And they think that some of the problems he has now are because the people who he replaced for those guys who went on the better jobs don't have the same kinds of skills. And so that oftentimes it isn't so much the person who is in charge, but the kind of help he has. You talked about earlier off the air, you talked about a lady who answered the phone so well.
Incredible.
She was not the boss, but she was a great public relations person for the company she worked for, because she handled the customers so well. Mm-hmm. I walked into a store the other day before I even got in the door. Hi, can I help you? I said, wow, because usually I can't find what I want. But she was right there. She was not the owner, but he obviously had the right person to greet people when they came in, to get them pointed in the right direction. Yeah. So that owner knows who to put where, when, and how. And they often say the person who answered the phone or the person who greets people are two of your most important employees.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
And when you're in business for yourself, you have to be that person who answers the phone and the person who is the first direct line of customer service. So that's, customer service is essential, especially if you're a small business owner and you're running it by yourself. Yeah. A lot of times in my case, I do freelance for different publications, Reading Eagle and things like that. I have to make sure that, because I'm providing a service for them, that I have to make sure that I'm thinking about customer service and maintaining a good rapport with the editors and the different people that I'm connecting with. I've recently started writing artist bios for music artists and things like that. So I have to make sure that I'm providing that one-on-one personal, the best customer service I could provide. I think that's a key with any business, small business or otherwise, customer service.
A lot of what we talk about with a lot of people is when they start their business is to understand their value. What is the value that you are bringing to your business? Because a lot of times people will spend time doing something in their business that they really should be paying somebody else to do.
Mm-hmm.
And it's hard, because I know you're starting a business, you're trying to save as much money as you can to build the business, but if your value to your business is $50 an hour, and you're doing bookkeeping 8 hours a week, that's literally $400, correct? Help me if my math is wrong. And you might be able to pay a bookkeeper $100 a week to do that. You're actually losing money because you're doing business yourself. You're taking money out of your pocket because you're not doing what it takes for you to make money when somebody else could be doing those types of work for you. Another question I would have is, what are the biggest challenges you face as a banker when people come into the for loans? What are
probably lack of preparation. But a lot of times you can't really fault to the client or the prospect too much because nobody has ever taught them what is necessary or what you need to build up in order to get off to a solid start. So I would say preparation and sometimes just directionless. Like, those are probably the biggest challenges. You know, obviously, reputation is one thing. I don't mean reputation so much as who you are as a person, although that does have a large part to do with it. But, you know, just things like credit education, financial education and literacy and things like that. You know, don't wait for people to come and tell you about it. Go find it yourself. I mean, we live in an age where literally, like, all human knowledge is in the palm of your hands, you know, and people still get it wrong. So it's one of those things, like, don't get it wrong. You know, look into it and really give yourself the tools to really make a difference in how you start your business.
Dr. Amprey, here's something I'd like to share. In doing research, like with our Kauffman Foundation affiliation we have now with my Entrepreneurs Connection Group, we are now affiliated with the Kauffman Foundation, which is the largest entrepreneurial foundation in the world, and they have a great program to help people get started in business. Pennsylvania ranks 38th in entrepreneurship. 38th in entrepreneurship in the country. And to me, that's a sad statistic for us. I promise you, there are a lot of people in Redding and Berks County who could have wonderful businesses if they have the, if they're willing to take the risk, if they're willing to do the work it takes to start a business the right way, if they're willing to talk to people to see if they're looking at a business that makes sense, you know, can they build a relationship with the bank? Are they willing to go talk to some attorneys and some financial people to make sure it's being done the right way? It's very interesting that we are that far behind, because I promise you, small business runs this country. You can Google it. You can do your research. When you see what small business means to America, it's really fascinating. And one of the things in my experience is, I've met thousands of business people from all over the world because of some of the businesses I've had. And a lot of people make a mistake where they think success in business has something to do with intelligence. Nothing could be further from the truth. I know a lot of very smart people who weren't very successful in business. I know a lot of people who didn't do as well in school and are very, very successful because they were so focused on what they wanted and they knew exactly what it was going to take to get from here to there. So if you have some notions of what you think it really takes to be successful, I would say talk to people first, because they're probably not all true. There are a lot of different ways to be successful. And when we look at minorities in business, one of the things when I did a little bit of research today, and it's really hard to get accurate or not up-to-date information, but in looking at it, 29% of our population, 29.3% are small business owners. The black community make up 12.6% of the population, 9.5% of them are self-employed. The Asian community, they make up 5% of the population, 7.1% of them are self-employed. And then the Hispanic community, they make up 16.9% of the population, 12.2% of them are in business for themselves. Those are staggering statistics for me, because I think what that tells me is that there's a lot of opportunity out there for people. And please feel free, if you think you have any idea of what you think is a good business idea or something that you would like to even consider or think about, talk to the right people to see if that makes sense.
And again, I've learned so much from other people in business, or other businesses. They get together, and, you know, when I was doing my drum and I was struggling, I called together some of the most successful businessmen in town who gave me all kinds of practical things that I should have been doing. And I've said this over and over again. I've learned more about the psychological behavior from businessmen than anybody else, you know, because we have all these theories, but they are involved with people. They know how they spend their money. They know how they spend for what they need and what they want. Sometimes we don't buy what we want, we buy what we want. And then they know we have. One thing that I find fascinating in talking to a car salesman is that the person will say, I want something practical, but then they want something that looks good. Mm-hmm. And oftentimes, when I'm buying something that looks good, I'm not being practical, you know. But nevertheless, they know how we spend. So again, we need to really look at all the issues. One of the things I'm always fascinated with is I hear the word advertising, and I hear the word marketing, and I'm told they aren't exactly the same thing. That that marketing is bigger than advertising. That I guess when I think of advertising, I think of an ad on TV or radio or jingle. And when I hear you guys talk about marketing, you talk about planning, how something is presented, when to present it. So I think, but if you're going to start a business, you look at all those little details.
If I may address this, because it's something that I've been involved in, because I'm certified by Constant Contact to teach social media and email marketing the right way. And if you look at what marketing and advertising was 15 or 20 years ago, what it is now, it's fascinating how much it's changed. Mm-hmm. There's a reason there's no longer a Newsweek magazine. There's a reason that Time magazine went from this many pages to this many pages, because the world changed. Communications have changed. And if you're not keeping up with those things, and again, that's why you have surround yourself with professionals. Marketing, it's fascinating how quickly that industry changed. And you're only as good as the marketing. It has a purpose. It's to find your target market. It's about sharing free relevant information about who you are and what you do, so that when people want to buy your product, need your product or service, they already know exactly where they're going. With social media and email marketing, every day's an opportunity to tell people about exactly what it is that you do, so that when they need your service, they already know where they're coming. Mm-hmm. It's a fascinating world. You probably have some insights.
Yeah, I guess you could say the internet and social media have changed everything.
Everything.
Without a doubt. Mm-hmm. Because you no longer have to go to your audience. Your audience is already on social media. Like, I've gotten a number of opportunities and speaking engagements and customers just based off of Instagram alone. Just putting a visual images of what I'm doing on a regular basis and tying that and making sure that you can't just post without a purpose. That's what I like to say. I always like to post pictures and things that have to do with my message and the message of my company and my brand. So social media is everything now. Not everything, but it's a big part of how you can market and advertise the services that you provide.
And I guess also, since you're a writer, mm-hmm. for example, I buy books. My son buys puts things on Kindle.
Right.
I would give him gift cards to bookstores. He says, Dad, I'm not even using that. He uses a Kindle. I'm an old man. I don't use a Kindle. So I need to wake up to the modern world. So the social media and the internet have just changed things. And for some of us older guys, it's too fast for us to keep up with.
And that's why I think also, as Chuck brought up a great, everyone's brought up great ideas as far as having mentors and people that have been in business longer than you, but it's also a great idea to work with and learn from people who are younger than you. So I'm 35, but I'm blessed enough that I work with at the high school, and now some of the students, I've been there for 11 years, and some of those students that I have, like Lisa Tejada, Mateo Toro, John Zabala, these are all young, up-and-coming entrepreneurs in their own right, and I learn from them all the time. Some of them consider me a mentor to them, but I also consider them a mentor to me, because I think any good mentorship is I'm learning and you're also learning. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So the mentorship should go two ways. So I think it's always a good idea to keep people 10 years older than you around and 10 years younger, mm-hmm. if not more.
That is a great point.
I
hear people say all the time, kids these days and millennials. I had a lot of lazy friends growing up. I mean, it really isn't that different. And the point that you made was a couple young entrepreneurs joined our Entrepreneurs Connection group a couple years ago. They were both college students, and my first thought was, oh, we'll teach them something. And I'm telling you, within 2 weeks, they were teaching us something. And these were solid entrepreneurs. And it was fascinating because they were teaching us things that we had no idea of, how the world was changing and what was important and how to make just looking at things differently and making critical decisions with more with better information. You're right. I mean, we actually worked with a couple high school entrepreneurs in the last couple of years who are going to be very, very successful.
Well, one of the things that frightens us now is that we have young people who have computer skills. And they don't graduate. Mm. They leave school and get mega bucks with the skills, that beyond those of the professor teaching them. I had an ex-student of mine who opened up a pet cemetery. Mm. This is down in Maryland. P people will actually take their, when they bury their dogs and cats in his cemetery, and they actually have tombstones and things like that. I need to get down and see how that's doing, but that was years ago. But he's found a market, and I met that market. I'm a big seafood fanatic, and I met a man who has a seafood store here in Reading, and he needed a loan to get started, and he couldn't get anybody locally to lend him because they weren't convinced that there was a market for it. Mm-hmm. But he went down to Maryland, where seafood's a big deal, right, and a bank down there lent him the money. Mm-hmm. And of course, he's brought the seafood here because, you know, so he's actually selling Maryland seafood here in Berks County. He's done very well.
I think that raises a great point, is that when someone says no, you just keep going until you find you find that yes that you need. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's going to take some work. I know the first time I submitted my manuscript to my editor, it was no. You know, like, you need to fix this and do this. And it was, you know, it was a shot to the ego. But one of the things that I was determined to do is to get my manuscript right, work on the things that I needed to work on, submit it to him again. And the next time that I did, he was happy to work with me. So it's just in business, I think, and in life in general, I think you just have to have that determination, especially if you're going to be in business for yourself, to not look at your no's as a permanent no. It's just an obstacle, just a holding space until your next yes.
And David, as a young writer, the things you can teach me, because you know about blogs or about the internet, mm-hmm, and I'm always thinking about print media, which is becoming obsolete. A few minutes ago, Chuck talked about there's no Newsweek because people, you know, I had to learn that when I was doing my newspaper, that they do more reading online than they do mm-hmm on hard print. Yeah. And the older guys want hard print, but the young guys want, you know, and you mm-hmm know,
yeah,
which groups need which.
Mm-hmm. And now they don't really like to read at all. So now even the digital articles are not very long, purposely. You mm-hmm just want to get your point across in a 2-3 paragraphs.
Keep it short.
Yeah, because attention span is so short.
The whole purpose of what we're talking about now is so important, because what has really changed over the years is business is now about building relationships. I mean, really, my whole business is built on relationships, that what I can't help a client with, I can refer them to the right people. And I don't refer friends. I try to do my best to refer the right people to the right people. It's the same as we started the show, is you want to build a relationship with your bank. Mm-hmm. It's not just about going in and signing papers. It's about building a solid relationship, that they get to know you and you get to know them. It's the same in all areas of your business. It's fascinating how much it's changed. But, you know, years ago, you'd get your salesman would come in, and they were the pushy salesman that would pick up the contract and shove it in front of you. And if you sign this today, you get coverage today. That's long gone. People want to know. A big part of business right now about marketing is blogging. Mm-hmm. The more people get to know you, the more that they know about you, that their comfort level rises. That's who people mm-hmm want to do business with.
Yes.
People they know, like, and trust.
It's fascinating.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah, I was talking to a man who ran a local car dealership, and he said his best salesmen build relationships.
Yeah, absolutely.
And people refer them back because he's a nice guy, he took care of me. And the other thing I was found fascinating with the car dealer business, but they talk about the importance of the service end. Mm-hmm. That they buy the car, but when they get it serviced, is the service free for a year? Or is the service really good service? So that is all part of the whole marketing process. It was fascinating. So much that we don't understand about the big picture.
You know, so many things have changed. I mean, thinking back like 20 plus years ago when we were in high school, so many things have changed over the years, but there are certain constants. And always I feel that it rings true to promote your personality. You know, people will gravitate towards your attitude if it is an attitude that appeals to them, right? Mm-hmm. You know, in physics, we learn opposites attract, but that's not always accurate in the business world. You know, what is your competitive advantage? Why is it that you want to go? Why is it why you'd want to go with you as a business provider? And really be conscious of that with every interaction. You're always on stage. You're always being watched, and you know, it's not so much who you know, what you know, but who knows you nowadays.
We're almost out of time. I'm going to ask all three to give information how we can get in touch with you for help in the areas that you, if you want to get into writing. How do we contact you again, David?
The, The best way to contact me would be on social media or my email, nazariod@yahoo.com. You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Scared of a Day Job, and you can check out more about the book at makeloveyourreligion.com.
If you want to contact Chuck about helping you with a business, Chuck?
You can reach me by phone, 484-638-3975, or email me at chuck@chuckholder.com.
A friendly banker?
Friendly banker, email is the best way to reach me.
Okay.
Lewis.Guzman@wellsfargo.com. Look forward to getting that.
Again, we're almost out of time. If you want to get back to me about future shows or suggestions or ideas, my information will be up in a few minutes. Please get a hold of me. I want to thank my guests, David Navarro, Chuck Holder, Luis Guzman, for joining us tonight. Good night. God bless.
Good night.